Hello, everyone. Today I'm going to be reviewing the fourth studio album by American artist Sara Bareilles. This album is titled Amidst the Chaos, and it was just released this last week. I'm really excited to finally talk about a new Sara Bareilles album, as she has not released an entirely what she considers pop music record in nearly 6 years. Her last album came out in 2013 called Blessed Unrest. I have reviewed it on this channel. I had glowing things to say about it. It was one of my, if not my favorite album of 2013, I think, if not definitely deserving album of the year title for that year, I would say. And an album that I think was still criminally slept on by like the Grammys and a lot of music awards, even though it was nominated. Sara Bareilles is an artist that deserves a lot more recognition. She puts in so much heart and soul, and she is such a talented singer slash songwriter. She brings both sides of that talent to the table equally. She puts her heart and soul into everything she does, but she is consistently overlooked, I think, by the mainstream media. I mean, she broke out with her hit song Love Song back in 2007. That was everywhere. But then people were like, oh, okay, that's cool, but we're not going to like listen to so much of her other music. I mean, she's made it. She's made herself a household name in many ways, but I still think, especially in the pop landscape in terms of Billboard and charts, she's only ever really had success with that song, Love Song, and also her song Brave off of her album, The Blessed Unrest, that came out 6 years ago. Between that album and now, she wrote a Tony-nominated Broadway musical called Waitress. And she released an album full of songs that she sung, that she had written for that production. And I've listened to the album, but I have not seen the Broadway show. I've heard it's amazing. The song She Used to Be Mine was like a huge hit from that album. So she does talk about with her career that being sort of this monumental sort of big step. And to be completely honest, I wasn't entirely sure when she stepped into sort of the Broadway world that she was actually ever going to really come back to pop music in the same way. I kind of thought maybe that was where she was heading. And I definitely wasn't expecting a new album anytime soon by that regards. But then we found rumors that she was starting to write again, and here we are. And I'm so excited because it's been a long time, but it feels like home listening to her voice again. And it reminds me just how strongly I gravitated towards her album 6 years ago. That album represented like a huge thing for me at that time in my life. Like I'll just always remember that point in my life when I listened to that album and her previous records as well. But I have to be honest, I haven't necessarily listened to every single song off of some of her earlier records. Like I've heard a lot of them, but I didn't really dive into them the same way as I've done more recent works of hers. And that's something that I need to change, but it's hard. There's so much music to listen to and, you know, but what's really sad, I think, is that this time around, she is being slept on by almost everyone. Like, I had to like fight this one Twitter page to just be like, tweet about this new album. Like you tweet about everything else that's like big and pop, but why aren't you covering Sara Bareilles? Like no one's talking about this. And I really wanted to make sure that I did because I really love her music and I would consider myself a huge fan. And this record is getting criminally slept on by a lot of the mainstream media. I will say I am so glad that she was on SNL this weekend because that's sort of the big promotion that she really needed and deserved. She performed two songs and she did amazing. So I'm really happy. And she even got to do She Used to Be Mine. She got to perform that song in a skit. Where Kate McKinnon played Theresa May. It was hilarious. I highly recommend checking it out. All right, enough backstory. So Sara talks about this album really conceptually being born at a very important and pivotal moment in our country's history, the 2016 presidential election. I knew that Sara was probably going to concoct a record that was going to have political undertones. I mean, many artists have. She was one of the many outspoken artists to attend the Women's March in Washington, D.C. in January of 2017, which I also attended, which is crazy for me to say. I don't live too far from Washington, D.C., so I went with my family to that march, and boy, oh boy, do I never want to be amongst that many people for that long a period of time in the winter ever again, but I will say it was very much worth it going. And I didn't get to see like a lot of celebrities speak, but I heard them over like loudspeakers. There were so many people, it was hard to get near a stage. But Sara Bareilles was there, you know, she was very fired up, and her lead single off of this record, Armor, is a tribute to that in many ways. She has footage from that in a music video for that song, and if you listen to the lyrics, it's very clear that along with the Me Too movement, which was a big thing that started happening around that time, we had a lot of a conceptual thrust behind a song that felt needed to be made for our day and age. And so here we have Amidst the Chaos. That is a wonderful title for our current socio-political climate right now, not just in America, but in the world. And the album cover is this beautiful kind of understated, windswept black and white look where you can't really tell if it's a happy or sad pose. It's just this sort of like moment of connection, I think, that is very visceral. It's very raw. And that's something that I think represents this album beautifully. You know, this is a very, in some ways, raw and black and white album. Her previous work maybe was a little less dark than I think you could say this album is. This is probably her darkest record. And it's not like it's goth or anything. It's just the subject matter, and if you look into the lyrics and everything, there's some real angst, and there's also a heaviness that you can hear in some of the way she delivers the vocals. Like, there's this maturity, and she is turning 40 this year. You know, she's a seasoned, you know, singer here at this point. Like, she's really, really leaning into her beautiful, buttery vocals that are so beautiful live. Like, she is an amazing live performer, just as she is on a studio record. And, she really leans into that, and that soulful voice comes through, and you can sense the maturity, you can sense the age, but this, like, it's just like a ripening, you know? And for most of this record, I really feel like this really visceral, emotional connection that I've always felt from her music. I mean, her music has always been very emotional, very relatable, something you can cry to, something you can just relate to, because her lyrics are so clear-cut, so hard-hitting. And yet at the same time, she crafts such beautiful poetry. I mean, she makes, you know, many of the great poets run for their money with some of her songwriting. Like, seriously. Also, she writes almost everything herself. In fact, this album is a little unique in that she wasn't afraid to work with co-writers this time around. For The Blessed Unrest, she was like, no, this is my record. I'm making this myself. But on this album, she's still the writer for everything, but she co-writes a little bit here and there with other big heavyweights like Justin Tranter, Lori McKenna, she's like a country songwriter, Emily King. So she comes in with some other people to help piece in the puzzle a little bit and be a little bit more collaborative this time around, which is not a bad thing by any means. It's still very much her record. Opening up, we have the single, this was the second single off of this record, we have The Feisty Fire. Now, I'll be honest, when I first heard this song, I wasn't absolutely loving it. I felt as though it's a song that has in the production, like, something that makes you think it's like an anthem, like it's something that will get you moving in some ways. But there's something kind of heavy about the layering of her vocals, about the melody construction, that I felt was a little haphazard in parts. It's a song that takes some getting used to, I think, when you talk about the melody construction. She is vocalizing and harmonizing with some of her backing singers. And I think the layering of that really adds this richness. And I do think there's this chaotic energy to it that really reminds me of fire in many ways. It's unpredictable and it's blazing hot, but at the same time kind of smothering. And that's how this song kind of feels to me. I don't think it shows off her vocals nearly as much as other songs on this record. And I don't think it's a standout melodically. But I think it's a not bad choice for a lead single and a great way to open up the album. It adds that brooding kind of energy, but this is much more of a classic sort of bitter post-breakup song. We were never going to catch fire. We burned up into the flames long before they ever rose up higher. Someday I won't have to feel the cold, but I do now, so I'll know what it feels like when I feel fire. I love that sentiment. It's like, okay, well, at least I know when it's real, it's going to be real. Because right now it's not real, and now I know how to tell the difference. Track number two is No Such Thing. This was a promotional song off of this record. This song has some very interesting instrumentation in that it's got this light piano work that's very lilting mixed with some harps and mandolin sounds. But at the same time, it's very heavy, where at parts in the verses with her voice, but she shows that dynamic. She can reach these beautiful high notes. So it's very sing-song, but it's also very kind of reflective and mournful. This song comes across as like a post-breakup, you know, denial anthem. Like, what do I do after you? Like, how can I move on? But actually, Sarah has been very open about how a lot of these songs are actually a lot more directly about the 2016 presidential election and the leaving of office from President Barack Obama. It's a little heavy hitting when you think, gosh, girl, it's not, you know, that's very dramatic for you to write a song quite like this, a song that feels so much like a love song about Obama like this, but I get it at the same time. I totally empathize. We all feel a little bit like we're in the ruins and we don't know where to go to step up from that. And I hear that sort of like unsuredness in the way she delivers that. And I think it comes across beautifully. So, I mean, it's a little on the nose, but I totally get it. Track number three was the lead single. This is Armor. I wanted to talk about this song back in the fall when it came out, but I was sick at the time and I never got the chance to cover it. So I'm glad I'm getting to talk about it now. This is like the culminating sort of anthemic political song on this record. It's the most obviously political in that it is obviously talking about women's rights, equality. The Me Too movement comes to mind. She was inspired by all of the stuff that's been going on in the tumultuous political climate right now that we live in. This is a song, it's a call to arms, but a call to unity. And it feels very open. It doesn't feel exclusive to just women, even though that's primarily where she's focusing these lyrics. Now, I will say the lyrics are extremely beautifully written in poetry. Just the way she opens up, let it begin, let Adam in, step one, original sin. Underneath the leaves, Adam found Eve. Both of them found something sweet under the apple tree. Then it was over, roads divide. Step two, learning how to lie. Let me ask a question to present day. How the hell did Eve end up with all the damn blame? What a great way to open and throw it all the way back to Genesis, right? Like, this is a problem that is deeply rooted culturally, going way back to the beginning. The gender crisis, the gender divide. That's a very controversial and very sort of heavy philosophical thing to bite into, and I love that. I love that she's mixing in like all of these different elements of history to create and paint a picture of the current climate we live in. She, you know, is saluting the ones who came before her, to the scientists, the poets, the people who sowed quiet seeds of self-reliance, think like Rosa Parks, bloomed in me, so here I am. You think I am high and mighty, mister? Wait till you meet my little sister. You ain't seen nothing yet if you think I'm a boss. You know, so all together, we are stronger. You can't knock us down. I think instead of it being like very kind of like, I don't want to say generic in lyricism like her song Brave was, which a lot of people kind of attributed to the LGBTQ movement, you know, LGBT rights, like I'm brave and I'm going to say what I'm going to say and I'm going to come out loud and proud. Those lyrics were, you know, very on the nose. They were very direct about like, this is kind of what the song's about, but there's a lot of open room for interpretation. So they were just a little generic lyrically. Whereas like this song, which is much, you know, also about a specific topic, is much more direct and much more specific in certain areas. And I think it makes for stronger songwriting. So I like that progression. You can tell that she's so well learned, that she's so well read, that she really wants to create a song that like ties a lot of things together and she's reckoning with all of this. So it's a beautiful example of that. And I just love the rumbling nature of it. Like I said earlier, it's not quite so dynamic in terms of vocals. It's very kind of monotone in many ways, but at the same time, I think it fits this sort of one shade of color that she's really throwing out, the color of the shield, you know, the silver armor that we have. It's a little rusted, like it's rumbling and it's building and percolating over time because things are just getting so difficult and so tenuous. Next, we have If I Can't Have You. Now, this is a much more sort of throwback sounding jazz number. That I think of it as that. I mean, I'm not so good with some of these musical references. I definitely find it uplifting. I can't help but just sway back and forth to it. The backing vocals that she brings in to add sort of these key changes, just add all these nice rich textures and flavors. Carole King comes to mind a lot. I know people have referenced her. She's referenced Carole King as a huge inspiration. So that's going to come up a lot in terms of people thinking, oh, this sounds like a Carole King song, or she's got that energy. You know, I also get a little bit of Aretha Franklin in a lot of these songs, you know, like that soul is really coming through. And If I Can't Have You is another song that, again, You could think of it as a simple post-breakup blues kind of track where you're trying to find the positive in a dark situation. But again, she knows that this song was written with Barack Obama in mind, and Michelle, of course. We miss both of them so much. And I think for, especially with this song, like I really do, this, I feel like it's much more kind of open. It's not so much directly about a relationship. It's just like when you've lost something that you were relying on and was, you were finding strength from for so long. And now you're like, how do I go on? How do I figure out how to keep living? I mean, it's kind of dark and heavy, but like, that's the place that we're in many ways. And that's how I felt, I know, for several days, at least after that election. Like, it was just this, like, where do we go from here? Like, we need help. SOS. And yet at the same time, like, this song has a hopeful attitude. It's not completely dark and dirge-like. It's actually quite hopeful in that it's upbeat. So definitely a highlight for sure. Track 5, Eyes on You. I'd say this song is sonically the most different from a lot of the others. This has a distinct 80s sound. It has the percussive nature of it that just reminds me of that. And also there's a little bit more, her microphone is like, it's just a little different, like the sound we're getting from her voice and the production. It's painting a picture of a dysfunctional family, a dysfunctional life. Tommy took a free fall, didn't pull the ripcord. Gathered at the funeral, everybody looked bored. You want to laugh, but you're like, that's dark. Oh my God, what's going on here? Amanda had a baby, Katie, she lost a few. And when the smoke gets thick, I can't help it but hear tick, tick, boom. I can't help but think about, like, you know, like your biological clock ticking when people think about pregnancy. And then, oh, that's dark. She talks about mental disorders when she brings up this person and how everyone's dealing with something in their lives that doesn't necessarily translate on the surface. You never know what's going on underneath someone's turmoil or someone's pretty facade. So this is really interesting. Apparently, she said in Variety magazine that the song mentions real names of people she met in therapy or a meditation class after she was in a very dark place herself after the 2016 presidential election. So she's like anecdotally collecting different people's experiences and placing them into this song. At life, it gets louder. Can't stop. It won't slow down. Lost in all this. All I can do is keep my eyes on you. Keep my eyes on the prize. What does she mean by on you? Is she talking about faith? Is she talking about hope? Is she talking about a romantic partner? Family? It could be, it's very open and broad. And I think that, you know, when she sings in the bridge, I keep my eyes on the horizon. That's really just, this song is about hope in a dark place where we're all struggling with mental demons. And I think it's brilliant, again, that this is, again, bringing up the presidential election. I think she's just so unafraid to talk about that. Actually, I was listening to an interview with her on NPR, and the interviewer asked her, like, are you afraid of alienating your fans by being this transparent about your political viewpoint? And she's like, you know, at this point in my career, I really don't care. And I really resonate with that. Like, she cares much more about her own mental health and translating that in the way she needs to create art to cope, that she's not going to sugarcoat it and be like, oh, it doesn't mean that. You know, like, no, this is what it means. This is what I was going through when I wrote this song. I don't care if you disagree with me or not. The songwriting is somewhat vague in certain areas where you can interpret it in a different way. So go ahead and do that. But if you have a problem with it, that's your problem, not mine. This is for us. This is for the people who are struggling with this. And this is a post-Barack Obama album that we all need, okay? Like, let's be real. Okay, probably my favorite song on this record, the sultry, smooth Miss Simone. We all know Nina Simone, right? Sarah Bareilles calls her the ultimate high priestess of soul. This song is, you know, very cute, and it's very late night with your partner, romantic moment on the balcony in the city, on the rooftop balcony. Just the two of us and Miss Simone. How do you know what a heart sounds like, Miss Simone? How do you understand so well these inner feelings I have around romance and love? I must admit, I need to listen to more of Nina Simone's music, but the songs I have heard, I totally get it. She is the high priestess of soul, totally transcendent. And this kind of comforting thing that Sarah uses her music as like a blanket to wrap her in to like also be this like comforting thing that when she's with her partner, there's this sacred tryst that's going on, but Miss Simone is sort of like the she's like almost in a way like the the priest at the marriage, in the marriage, like the secret little ceremonies that they have each night together. Miss Simone's always there. This song is just smooth like butter. Like I can't describe it, especially in the chorus. It's wistful, it's idyllic. The very soft instrumentation in the background, it just lulls you to sleep. It's a very good song to have in a bubble bath. So yeah, no, I am some red wine. I am totally in love with this song. I think melodically, it's probably the most stirring. All right, so number 7, we have Wicked Love. I think this song reminds me the most of The Blessed Unrest. I think it's just because it has that that pounding piano percussion. You know, that like traditional Sarah Bareilles beat that she uses the chords for. And the melody reminds me a lot of a song called Cassiopeia on that record. I'm not saying she's plagiarizing herself. I'm just saying I hear similarities in the melody construction. Lyrically, this song's like just... get out of my face, I'm done with you. Like, at least you taught me what love isn't. Poured my glass of wine, you caught me some fireflies, told me their names and how much they love their life in a jar. I wasn't expecting the lyrics to go there. Like, that's brilliant. You twist around me like vines, you rub the stars in my bright eyes, then you sold me a future from the one you had in the trunk of your car. The last verse on every like stanza is like the one that flips it all on its head in a negative way. And I think that's brilliant songwriting. Like, this is what I mean by her being an amazing poet. So ultimately she's seeing the red flags in this relationship. So she's finally able to like say, get out, honey. I see your wicked love. I don't want it. Don't need what makes me feel addicted. That's not necessarily how love should be. A song we can all relate to and belt out at the top of our lungs. Track number 8, Orpheus. Now, the title of this album is mentioned in the lyrics of this song. This is a slow burn type acoustic track. It was interesting because I was confused for some reason. I got Orpheus and Morpheus confused. Morpheus is the Greek god of dreams. And I was like, oh, this song is about dreams? And then I was like, I don't know, listening to the lyrics, I'm not so sure about that. Orpheus was a musician, poet, and prophet in ancient Greek mythology. He was the one who played the lyre. So that makes more sense. This is, you know, Sarah sort of embodying the god or goddess of music, of poetry. She's come by the fire, lay down your head. I see you've grown tired. Yes, Sarah, we've grown very tired. You so set the bad day by the bed and rest a while, your eyes can close. You don't have to do a thing, but listen to me sing. And the thesis statement of this song and of this album that comes through, say out loud, we will not give up on love now. Like, just keep the faith. We're going to be okay. We'll get through the stormy night and the brighter day will come for us tomorrow if we keep the faith. And we stay true to who we are, true to our beliefs, keep lifting each other up, community. Like, this is so important. So this is that sort of like moment of pensive reflection and of calm and the stormy album that is this record. A beautiful moment for sure. Number 9, Poetry by Dead Men. That song title made me laugh. That's just so on the nose. I love it. I would say this is definitely her hipster song. She's singing about things that I would consider very kind of hipster in a relationship. The song makes me think of bookstores in like Brooklyn that, you know, are next to vegan coffee shops. I wanted to be your girl with your hands on my skin, stirring in the cinnamon while you read me poetry by dead men. She's reading like what she really kind of wants out of a fantasy. Like, she's not afraid to like say, this is what I want a relationship to do. But at that point, she's talking about how her boyfriend at the time wasn't quite there yet. And she was like, oh, this is probably going to go like how things have gone before, you know, one and done. Thank you. Next. I'm going to keep disappearing or you're going to keep disappearing. Like, I'm tired of waiting for this man to be the one I'm waiting for. And I love that she's exploring that. You know, she doesn't necessarily have a resolution to this. She's just acknowledging that this is kind of what she always dreamed and imagined romance was going to be like for her. I think it's a very kind of witty, kind of sarcastic song in a lot of ways. And I hear her personality in these lyrics. So honestly, I mean, if anything, I will say melodically, this song doesn't really do as much for me. I don't really think like it's finding a melody. It's more like literally just trying to like create a song for the sake of the lyrics, not so much for the sake of the sonics. And that's okay in certain areas on this record. Like, as long as not every single song is in that direction, I'm totally fine with it. But yeah, is it my favorite song sonically? No, definitely not. But lyrically, it's a gem. Someone who loves me. Again, another hard-hitting, smooth, soulful jazz song. She references St. Jude. He's the patron saint of lost causes. Any Florence and the Machine fans will recognize that name because Florence and the Machine has an iconic song called that as well. So I love that reference to St. Jude. St. Jude's wearing a smile. He wouldn't mind, I bet. I can't go face the world. My bones won't hold me up. So tell the saint of lost souls where to find me, softly sleeping here in the deep end of someone who loves me. The song could be quite dark until you get to that last lyric, and it's like, oh, you're not in some dark hole of depression necessarily. Like, you're in the arms of someone you love. And so this song is very much, and you can feel it in the delivery, again, like that moment where she just wants to be held and kept safe from the tumult outside. A lot of this album is about like searching for that moment of clarity, that moment of peace, that moment of reprieve from the craziness that surrounds you, all the tumult. Finding that in a romantic partner, I mean, gosh, that is definitely what I'm searching for right now. Yeah, universe, if you could help me out a little bit more, please. Because that definitely feels like the way out, right? It's just like, if I'm in the arms of someone I love, I don't care what happens outside. You know, like, I'm safe. But you have to learn to be single and deal with the crap, too. So that's the tricky line you got to figure out. But she's obviously happy. I know she's got a, like, longtime boyfriend at this point that she's madly in love with. So I'm super happy for her that she's found him and that she's found that sanctuary that she can run to, because everyone deserves that. It's just can be hard to find sometimes. And don't view yourself negatively if you have a hard time finding it. It's not your fault. I mean, it could be, but usually it's not, you know. Think about, love yourself. That should be your sanctuary. Okay, another big highlight from this record, Saint Honesty. This was recorded in one take, and it's a unique song because she really wanted this one to be recorded live and used straight, you know, to the cut on the record. You know, she didn't want to have to go through the whole production process the way the other songs are made, you know? Like, this was just one take, flaws and all, put it on the record. And I hear that in the voice. Like, the vocals are so rich. She has some amazing high notes. It's not 100% perfect. There are some pitch problems, but they work in this song because this song is imperfect. It's beautifully imperfect. And this song, it brings together, I think, all of the emotional sentiments of this record beautifully. Tying in, you know, references to our current political climate and the sort of cheeky way she's bringing in honesty. You know, that's definitely something we need more of in our current administration, that's for sure, that we're dealing with. To save us from all the lies, but also in the way that Saint Honesty, which is, you know, a beautiful way to sort of characterize a personality of an idea or concept of a trait of someone, is something we all need to sort of experience. And honesty is not always comforting. It rains down on us like a storm. And she mentions how wild it was to finally feel the climate instead of staying safe and warm. And a lot of ways I can see how the presidential election brought a dose of that, a dose of honesty. It's like, you know what? We were safe and warm before, but now we're confronting a lot of issues we'd never really fully confronted because of this happening. We're realizing the country has these issues that need to be addressed, that we are more divided than we once thought. But you know what? It's okay. Now we know things, we can address the problem now. Like, we're being rained down upon, we're being cleansed. And so this song really does feel like a spiritual baptism in that regard of, it's going to be okay. I know it doesn't feel it right now, but breathe in and soak in all of the rich, honest emotions that we're feeling these days. If anything, if you can take anything positive from the current political situation, we have learned a lot more about inequality and injustice, and we're tackling it much more fervently. We're, you know, much more unified, and yet there's still a lot going that could divide us, especially on the left in terms of politics, but we're much more sort of like focused on people's right to vote, people's right to exercise that vote and to use that and make meaningful change in your local community, or to really step up and be running for office if you thought you couldn't before. It's like, nope, I'm going to do it now. Salvation's coming in the morning. And now what we need is a little dose of your sweet Saint honesty. So yes, honesty, that pill you should take every night, that little spoonful of medicine, that it's not always sweet and sometimes a little bitter, but it's good for you. So a beautiful reflection on that from her. Bravo. An amazing song that showcases amazing instrumentation. Not much more I can say. A brave song, a very brave song. We end the album with a beautiful duet between Sarah and the singer John Legend. This song is a little bit more, I don't want to say Broadway, but this song feels, I mean, I understand why she ended the album this way. It's sort of like, again, that sentiment of finding a place to rest your head at night when you're feeling so weary. It's sort of like a bridge over troubled water. It's got that like sort of like gospel undertone of like, even though it's not a gospel song, it feels like a song that your youth pastor would want you all to sing in church with the strumming guitar. Like, we'll all find a safe place to land. Like, I feel that kind of vibe from it. John Legend, I think, brings that flavor to it. I think his vocals are more dynamic than hers are in this song. I think she sounds kind of tired. But you know what? That's not necessarily a fault, because we're all a little tired. This record is kind of tired. Like, this record feels like it's already existed for a long time. And I think that they play off of each other beautifully. They harmonize beautifully. They both have like classical kind of Broadway roots as well. So I think they kind of bring that stage element to it that I think would make it beautifully sung, performed live. And it's a beautiful sentiment that is also a lot about the southern border crisis, the refugee crisis that she was motivated to write about. These people fleeing, you know, violence in their home countries, but finding persecution in a country that was supposed to be about the land of the free and inclusion, and all of the trials and tribulations of people who are fleeing, or migrants who are, you know, displaced and are trying to find a home, and people who are trying to create safe havens for them to finally bring them some salvation and bring them some peace. So this is like a lighthouse in the stormy seas. Again, a lot how this album feels. This album is gritty. This album is witty. This album is wistful. This album is dark. This album is tired. This album is a lot of things. It's political. And I think it's a great statement record for her in her career right now, and for her to put out at this time. We need this record. We need to soak in and marinate into it. It's a tribute to the great soul and jazz legends of the past, a style that she hasn't embraced so openly on previous records, but I think it's a style that suits her. I'm not the biggest jazz fan by any means, and I like that she doesn't go too in that direction. But I think that the little influences here and there definitely suit her voice and her songwriting style. There's even some country, you know, thrown in there. I mean, it's got some country elements. Sarah's always flirted with country a little bit. So it's a nice amalgamation, but still pop, and still a record that definitely I think many people should listen to, irregardless of politics and all of that. It's still, you know, a record anyone can relate to. I mean, seriously, it's how can you find fault in that? You know, how can you find fault in Sarah? She's so human. She's so relatable. She's so comforting. Her voice, I mean, who is not going to love it, right? This is a record that's cross-generational appeal, old and young will love. And I highly recommend you please check this out. Again, she's not getting enough love with this record. And it was very important that I made this video, promoted it in the way that I could. So I hope you enjoyed my review of this record. I would definitely say my highlights would be Saint Honesty and Miss Simone, because those songs are just feel so good, and I think showcase her vocals or showcase her melody construction in the best way. And you know, I'm a sucker for that. But there's so much beauty to be found throughout this record. Yeah, lots of good stuff. So I hope you enjoyed this review. I'll link my review of The Blessed Unrest in the description. Leave me a comment. Let me know what you thought about this record. And I hope you all check her out if you haven't. And I hope you all have a wonderful, blessed day. Please give this a like and subscribe if you enjoyed. Peace, love, and light. Bye.
Salvation is coming in the morning. Now there's a little rain on our face from you, sweet Savior.